Jayo Radha Madhava Kunja Bihari. Jayam Vishnu Pad Paramahamsa Parvaja Gacharya Asto Tadasita Shishimad. His Divine Grace, A.C. Bhaktivedanta Swami Prabhupada Ki Jai. Jayam Vishnu Pad Paramahamsa Parvaja Gacharya Asto Tadasita Shishimad. Sringagul Srila Bhaktisiddhanta Saraswati Goswami Maharaj Ki Jai. Anantikodi Vaishnavinda Ki Jai. ISKCON BBT Founder Acharya Srila Prabhupada Ki Jai. Namacharya Srila Haridas Thakur Ki Jai. Premsukho Shri Krishna Chaitanya, Prabhu Nityananda Sri Advaita Gadadhar Srivasari Gaur Bhaktavinda, Sri Sri Radha Krishna Gopi Gopinath, Shyamakund Radhakund Gita Govardhan Ki Jai, Vrindavan Dham Ki Jai, Mayapur Dham Ki Jai, Navadvip Dham Ki Jai, Jagannath Puri Dham Ki Jai, New Dwarka Dham Ki Jai, Their Divine Lordship Sri Sri Rukmini Dwarkadish Ki Jai, Their Divine Lordship Sri Sri Jagannath Baldev Srimati Subhadra Ki Jai. Their Divine Lordship Sri Sri Gornitai Ki Jai. Srimad Bhagavatam Ki Jai. Jamunamai Gangamai Ki Jai. Tulsi Devi Bhakti Devi Ki Jai. Transcendental Book Distribution Ki Jai. Harinam Sankirtan Yajna Ki Jai. Hare Krishna Mahamantra Ki Jai. Transcendental Prasadam Distribution Ki Jai. Gaur Premananda Hare Bol. All glories to all the assembled devotees, Hare Krishna. All glories to all the assembled devotees, Hare Krishna. All glories to all the assembled devotees, Hare Krishna. All glories, Sri Sri Guru and Sri Gauranga. Glories to the Prabhupada. Om Namo Bhagavate Vasudevaya. Om Namo Bhagavate Vasudevaya. Om Namo Bhagavate Vasudevaya. What a nice garland. Okay, today we're reading from the Srimad Bhagavatam, 10th canto. We're going to do text number 31 all the way through text 39. There's practically hardly any purports. And if there is, there's some very, very short ones. So we'll just go all the way to 39. And it's all related. So what I'm going to do is I'm going to chant the verses myself, and then we'll chant the last verse together. Okay? So here, the demons are expressing their opinion after Kamsa had went to them for some advice. And after he finished speaking, this is what they advised Kamsa. If this is so, O king of the Bhoja dynasty, beginning today, we shall kill all the children born in all the villages, towns, and pasturing grounds within the past 10 days or slightly more. So what does that mean, if this is so? What are they referring to? Does anybody remember? Excuse me? Yeah. So it's describing here how that Kamsa's killer is born elsewhere. So if that's so, then they want to, let's kill them. And as we heard previously, when Durga appeared, the controller of the material nature appeared to Kamsa and frightened him. She warned him, don't unnecessarily kill children. She warned him, but yet We'll see what happens. The demigods always fear the sound of your bowstring. They are constantly in anxiety, afraid of fighting. Therefore, what can they do by their endeavors to harm you? So Kamsa is fearful, so now they're trying to pacify his fear. While being pierced by your arrows, which you discharge at all sides, some of them, who were injured by the multitude of arrows, but who desired to live, fled the battlefield, intent on escaping. Text 34. Defeated and bereft of all weapons, some of the demigods gave up fighting and praised you with folded hands. And some of them, appearing before you with loosened garments and hair, said, "O Lord, we are very much afraid of you." Text 35. When the demigods are bereft of their chariots, when they forget how to use weapons, when they are fearful or attached to something other than fighting, or when their bows are broken and they have thus lost the ability to fight, your majesty does not kill them. So Prabhupada explains in a short purport here. There are principles that govern even fighting. If an enemy has no chariot, is unmindful of the fighting art because of fear, or is unwilling to fight, he is not to be killed. Kamsa's ministers reminded Kamsa that despite his power, he was cognizant of the principles of fighting, and therefore he had excused the demigods because of their incapability. So, quote, "But the present emergency," end quote, the minister said, quote, "is not intended for such mercy or military etiquette. Now you should prepare to fight under any circumstances," end quote. Thus they advised Kamsa to give up the traditional etiquette in fighting and chastise the enemy at any cost. So just see. Translation for text number 36. The demigods boast uselessly while away from the battlefield. Only where there is no fighting can they show their prowess. Therefore, from such demigods, we have nothing to fear. As for Lord Vishnu, he is in seclusion in the core of the hearts of the yogis. As for Lord Shiva, he has gone to the forest. And as for Lord Brahma, he is always engaged in austerities and meditation. The other demigods, headed by Indra, are devoid of prowess. Therefore, you have nothing to fear. Short purport. Kamsa's ministers told Kamsa that all the exalted demigods had fled in fear of him. One had gone to the forest, one to the core of the heart, and one to engage in tapasya. Thus, you can be free from all fear of the demigods, they said. Just prepare to fight. So text 37. Nonetheless, because of their enmity, our opinion is that the demigods should not be neglected. Therefore, to uproot them completely, engage us in fighting with them, for we are ready to follow you. Purport. According to moral instructions, one should not neglect to extinguish fire completely, treat diseases completely, and clear debts completely. Otherwise, they will increase and later be difficult to stop. Therefore, the ministers advise Kamsa to uproot his enemies completely. So, text 38. As a disease, if initially neglected, becomes acute and impossible to cure, or as the senses, if not controlled at first, are impossible to control later. An enemy, if neglected in the beginning, later becomes insurmountable. So we're reading our verse today. This is text number 39. Mulam hi Vishnur Devanam Mulam hi Vishnur Devanam. Yatra Dharma Sanatanaha. Yatra Dharma Sanatanaha. Tasya Cha Brahma Go Vipras. Tasya Cha Brahma Go Vipras. Tapo Yajna Sa Daskinaha. Tapo Yajna Sa Dakshinaha. Mulam hi Vishnur Devanam. Yatra Dharmaha Sanatanaha. Tasya cha Brahma go vipras. Tapo yagna sa dakshinaha. Mulam hi Vishnur Devanam. Yatra Dharma Sanatanaha. Tasya cha Brahma go vipras. Tapo yagna sadakshinaha. Vaishnavis. The foundation. He indeed, Vishnu, is Lord Vishnu, Devanam, of the demigods, Yatra, wherein, Dharma, religious principles, Sanatanaha, traditional or eternal? tasya of this foundation. Cha also. Brahma, Brahminical civilization. Go, cow protection. Vipraha, Brahmanas. Tapa, austerity. Yajna, performing sacrifices. Sadakshinaha, with proper remuneration. Translation and purport by Srila Prabhupada. The foundation of all the demigods is Lord Vishnu, who lives and is worshipped wherever there are religious principles, traditional culture, the Vedas, cows, brahmanas, austerities, and sacrifices with proper remuneration. Please repeat. The foundation of all the demigods is Lord Vishnu, who lives and is worshipped wherever there are religious principles, traditional culture, the Vedas, cows, brahmanas, austerities, and sacrifices with proper remuneration. Purport. Here is a description of Sanatan Dharma, eternal religious principles, which must include Brahminical culture, brahmanas, sacrifices, and religion. These principles establish the kingdom of Vishnu. Excuse me, there's a spider. The kingdom of God, and no one can be happy. So these principles establish the kingdom of Vishnu, and without the kingdom of Vishnu, the kingdom of God, no one can be happy. Nate vidhu swartha gatim hi Vishnum. That's from the Bhagavatam 7.5.31. In this demoniac civilization, people unfortunately do not understand that the self-interest of human society lies in Vishnu. Durashyaya ye bahir artha maninaha. Thus they're involved in a hopeless hope. People want to be happy without God consciousness or Krishna consciousness because they are led by blind leaders who lead human society to chaos. The Asuric adherents of Kamsa wanted to disrupt the traditional condition of human happiness and thus defeat the devatas, the devotees and the demigods. Unless the devotees and demigods predominate, the asuras will increase, and human society will be in a chaotic condition. Jai. Om Agyana Tamarandasya Gananjana Salakaya Chakshus Unmilitam Yena Tasmaya Shri Gurave Namaha Shri Chaitanya Manobhistam Stapitam Yena Bhutale Swayam Upagadamayam Dadati Swapadantikam. Jai Shri Krishna Chaitanya Prabhu Nityananda Shri Advaita Gadadhar Shivasadi Gaura Bhaktivinoda. Hare Krishna, Krishna Krishna, Hare Hare. Hare Rama, Hare Rama, Rama Rama, Hare Hare. Vanchakopa Tubhyas Cha, Kripa Sindhu Bheva Cha, Patitanam Pavanebhyo Vaishnavebhyo Namo Namaha. Jai. So the verse again. The foundation of all the demigods is Lord Vishnu, who lives and is worshipped wherever there are religious principles, traditional culture, the Vedas, cows, brahmanas, austerities, and sacrifices with proper remuneration. So previously, we heard the Kamsa Gita, right? And now, we're hearing the Asura Gita. We see Kamsa was talking about karma, providence, how everything's under the control of the Supreme. He talked about the body and the soul. He even talked about attachment and material life and liberation. how we should, you know, we know what liberation means, to act with our body, mind, and words for Krishna. So if we have a goal that's external, then that is bad shelter. So here we see, even though Kamsa is quoting from the scripture externally, but inside, he's intensely selfish. Actually, he's not motivated by compassion. He's simply riding on the chariot of his mind. And that chariot of the mind, it can do 20 flips in like 10 seconds. So you see, just quickly, when the association, after he heard this Asura Gita, then he completely identified with his mind and he had no control over it. And how can one understand God if he, through this materialistic mind, which one has no control? So we just read the Asura Gita. What is it? It's just like barking and brain of the dog or the ass. He's telling him, don't be fearful. We know when, we know where, and we know how. And we must kill, we must uproot, get to the mula, the root. What's that? What is that? That's Vishnu. We must uproot the foundation of the brahmanas and Vishnu. And where is he? Where all these brahmanas are and where they're performing sacrifices and austerities and all these different things. So how can we get uprooted? Kill them. So this is their point of view. But we don't want the point of view of demons like dogs and asses. But actually we want the view of eternity from Krishna. We want Krishna's view. Because their view is simply like the dog and the vulture. Have you heard this story of the dog and the vulture? There was this funeral going on, and they were putting the dead body on the pyre, as they do to burn it. And the dog comes and preaches to the people and says, you know, he's already dead. The soul is gone. You should not be so attached. You should just leave. Become detached. Just leave. And then the vulture started to say, no. You know, you've been with him your whole life. You should offer proper respects and stay as long as you can until the night, and that'll be fine. Then you could go home. You should show proper respect. You should be, you know, like that. Are these motivated by compassion? Actually, the dog is thinking, leave now so that I can eat him before the vultures come. And the vultures say, no, stay till dark, because then the dog's going to go home. And then we could feast on him at night. So this is their motivation. This is Kamsa. He's very intensely selfish. And they'll do anything to attain their selfish means. So you could just see how consciousness is turned by association. That's who we are, our consciousness, what we identify with. It can change. So Prabhupada stresses the importance of sadhu sangha. There's a nice verse, sadhu sangha, sarva sastre kaya, lava mantra sadhu sangha, sarva siddhi haya. So Prabhupada mentions how we have our plans, everybody has their plans, you know, you have your plans, I have my plans. But actually, no one has his own plan, because everybody's bound by the laws of nature. And they must act according to their tendency in their material conditional life. So therefore, Prabhupada says, we must change our decision and follow the decision of Krishna and Krishna's devotees. And then you'll be rescued from this punishment of Yamaraj, which is going to happen. Even though these demons, they think they're going to get away with murder, but actually, as will be described at the end of this chapter, that whoever offends the Vaishnavas, whoever tries to hinder them, they will be completely destroyed. As they mentioned, Krishna is in the heart of them. Krishna resides in their hearts. So if he does, and that's true, you offend the Vaishnavas, that's like personally offending Krishna. It's like going up to Krishna personally and just doing some offense. So if you do offend the Vaishnavas, you are finished. And this is what happens to the demons, as we'll see throughout this 10th canto. Very wonderful activities of Krishna. So even though Kamsa was not uneducated, you know, he seemed to understand the laws of nature. But because of his association with his bad ministers, he couldn't make a clear decision about his own benefit. So therefore, he was finished. So again, the importance of sadhu sangha. So it mentions about Brahminical culture. They talked about that, and that we'll see more from verses coming up, how where this Brahminical culture is. There's truthfulness, there's cleanliness, and all these different wonderful qualities. If there isn't a Brahminical culture, then what is it going to be? Just business. Just bureaucratic sudra activities. What is this bureaucracy? Is that they become so overly concerned with just procedure, with the mechanical system, at the expense of efficiency or even common sense. So therefore, we have to have a Brahminical culture which is based on respect. It's flexible and it's personal. Otherwise, then, what's the use? It talks about the brahmanas, how to become a brahmana? Simply by associating with the brahmanas, associating with the transcendental literatures. Read Srila Prabhupada's books. Schedule that into your daily activities. Every day, give some time to read Srila Prabhupada's books, and you will become learned vipra. Definitely. And then it talks about tapasya. Actually, the whole third chapter of the Bhagavad Gita talks about sacrifice. And in the fourth chapter, it describes how anything we do for Krishna, that is transcendental. You offer your activities to Krishna, then it becomes spiritualized. This material energy is covered. Actually, the Brahma Jyoti, everything rests on Krishna's energy. The Brahma Jyoti is Krishna's effulgence. It maintains the entire spiritual world. And just a spark of that is reflected in the sun, which maintains the entire material world. This is the light of God. It's maintaining everything. So everything within this material world is Krishna. But when it comes in touch with Maya, then it's darkness. And that's this whole 4 billion miles wide. This is our home. And this is the only thing we can understand is what's within this 4 billion dark cave. Without the sun, we couldn't understand anything. But even though it's so dark, that if we actually use this material energy, just like if you have a disease, that same disease can be cured by the same thing practically. Just like you have a disease of the bowels, it's caused by too much dairy, you can actually cure it by therapeutically applying dairy product like yogurt, become cured. So in the same way, this darkness of ignorance can be uplifted. We can enlighten, we could bring the light in by doing everything for Krishna. This is tapasya, sacrifice. We have to sacrifice for Krishna. This is very important. This is actually the symptom of love. You commit, you're doing some painful activity that maybe you may not necessarily do. This is why we practice this culture of taking vows, the marriage ceremony. We take initiation, we become committed, we perform sacrifice. Otherwise, we cannot enjoy. Without sacrifice, you actually can't enjoy. Just like if you don't make the sacrifice of offering your food to Krishna, you don't get any prasadam. Prasadam is very enjoyable. How can you be happy without prasadam? So in the same way, if you don't offer all your activities to Krishna, your mind, body, and words, then how can you be happy and enjoy? So actually, without austerity, you're causing austerity and suffering. But with austerity for Krishna, you're actually causing pleasure. It's pleasurable to serve Krishna. Just like you love somebody, you do anything for them, but it's pleasurable, right? So this trouble itself becomes pleasure for the devotee because he's merging everything into transcendence. This is the process of Krishna consciousness. And then it talks about charity. This is another place. See, these demons know where to attack. So within our own society, we have to understand what these mean. Austerity, charity, Brahminical culture, understanding how to read. So they try to keep you in ignorance. They try to keep you in the dark. So charity also. You see how most people, they don't want to give to good causes. They're very cheap. You know, they don't believe in doing these different things. Why should you give money to the priests? Even we find today, right, you can ask Rabindranath. He'll perform sacrifices and sometimes they'll give him like a few bucks. It's not that the brahmanas expect to live in luxury, but actually charity should be understood. You perform sacrifices and you don't perform the proper remuneration as the demons understand in this verse. Then what happens? What kind of sacrifice is that without proper remuneration? What is it? In the mode of ignorance, yeah. So this is like the devotees. They don't have like a salary, but that doesn't mean that they're not taken care of. They should be given sufficiently so they can be comfortable and perform their Sanatana Dharma. So this is what we need to provide, and Prabhupada wants us to establish Sanatana Dharma. And also they mentioned cow. It's so important. the cow dung. Because we perform our rituals, and the rituals are so very important. We need the cow. It produces so many different things. It actually represents all the demigods, actually represents Krishna. We can spend like months. I mean, I could do a whole class just on the cow. But we're just going to talk about one aspect of the cow just to see the importance. And that's one of the most insignificant aspects of the cow. What is that? The stool of the cow. Cow dung. Just see one. We're not going to talk about milk or ghee or butter or, you know, all these wonderful things that's produced by the cow. Just the stool, I mean, the dung of the cow. We need it. It's okay. Nobody's going to stop you if you take cow dung and go wipe the floor on the altar here and actually leave it there. Just leave it caked on the floor. In fact, it'll purify the place. Not only that, it'll purify your mind. It'll purify your entire existence. It's so important, the cow. So for rituals, it's needed. And what to speak about just in daily life, it's very cheap fuel. You can live for months just on some cow patties to keep your house warm. But today, now the demons want to destroy that. Why? So you could buy their kerosene, so you could buy their gas. It becomes costly, and you pay them money, and they get rich, and they supposedly enjoy. But you could save energy, you could save money, and become self-sufficient, free from all these different things. So this is really important. So this cow dung is also used for fertilizer. It's the most perfect fertilizer. Actually, instead, what they're using now is harmful chemicals. These chemical fertilizers. And it destroys, it makes the land barren. It makes the food not very nutritious. It makes people sick. This is what the demons want to destroy. They want to sell you their chemicals. They want to try to take over material nature. Actually, people are raising cows for milk, and they're so blind that because it stops giving milk, they'll kill the cow, and they'll sell it, and they'll be able to maintain themselves from the money for maybe a few days. But they don't realize the cow could live for another 5 years, and it could give you cow dung. And with that cow dung, you can support yourself for 5 years. Instead of be dependent on the cow and the bull, we become dependent on the so-called government, the demoniac kings. And we borrow money, get loans for tractors, fertilizers. And then what happens? The food grains are not even nutritious. They have no value practically, they're useless. There's some devotees in India, they went to this farm. This guy raised cows, he had like 150 plus acres, and he had like 1,000 cows. And this had this area where it was just full of cow dung and urine. And he said, this alone is enough for me to maintain my 150 acres just from this. And I have plenty left over to maintain myself. So one cow, as described, can give like to 10 to 20 kilos of dung. And just think, if you have 1,000 cows and you sell one kilo for one rupee, you could practically make $5,000 a day. You could make 1.5 lakhs per month. And then you could use it for other things. You know, so many things. If you have to keep it, you could use it to make your own gas. So this is what happens when you slaughter the cow. It causes so much unemployment. Especially for the women you see in India, they gather all these cow dung, they make these cow chips and they plaster it on the wall. They're unemployed because of that. Cobblers are unemployed because they're unnecessarily killing the cow before it dies naturally. So there's no ahimsa leather. So therefore they're out of work because they're sold too soon. They kill them then they export the leather. So it's unemployment for millions. Even these builders for homes, they would build homes and houses with clay and dung. They would actually make the tiles for the roof, and they build the walls that are counted dung. They're unemployed because of that. And even the health of women is so much affected, because in order for a woman to have natural childbirth, they have this special massage oil that's formulated, and it has to be lit by cow dung. You get a cow dung cake and you light it and you make this special oil formulation. And then they rub that on the child and the mother, and it protects them from all kinds of diseases, infections, so many different things. But now what do they want you to do? Go to the hospital and they smear you with alcohol or so many chemicals and drugs. And it's expensive. Not only do they destroy your health and kill you, but they charge you for it. It's not cheap to be cheated. This is the demons. So even the ash of the cow dung can be used. They use it for washing pots. You can shine your pots very nicely. It purifies your water. Can you imagine that? And you could even make toothpaste, brush your teeth with it. It's very nice. So we have to allow the cows to live. Even after the cow gives milk, you get so much, as we described. And you could become independent. You can actually become rich. So Prabhupada says, just 1 acre of land and one cow, you could become self-sufficient. So we have to promote cow protection, go seva. Otherwise, then how are we going to usher in the Sanatana Dharma that Prabhupada is talking about here? It's so important, this Sanatana Dharma, that Prabhupada says we should tolerate all inconveniences and go ahead without, you know, the demons. They are always against the devotees. We see this battle going on here. It's a war between the demons and the devotees. It's going on today. You can't even go outside and breathe properly. You get sick if you go out and breathe the air in some places. You can't even drink the water. Get sick. The food you eat is not really real food. This is the society of demons. But yet, if we follow the Srimad Bhagavatam and its teachings, follow the sadhus, the brahmanas, and protect them, then we will become completely happy. We'll be satisfied. You'll really enjoy. So Sanatan Dharma can be applied anywhere. And we see we're doing it now, even though we see we're living in such a hellish condition all over the world. We don't have to have this even in place, because this is Lord Chaitanya's movement. And this is his contribution, is that no matter where you are, you can even be in prison and you can have Sanatan Dharma. Because the nature of the soul is eternal, and its nature is simply to fall in love with Krishna. What is that verse? Prema Paman. How's it go? Prema Paman, yeah. This is the nature of the soul, is to love Krishna. We fall in love with Krishna, we can fall in love with Krishna anywhere. But we have to develop that. It may be hard without this Sanatana Dharma in place, but Srila Prabhupada wanted that, wanted to establish this Sanatana Dharma. So it makes it easier for everyone to perform bhakti and not dependent on so many things. And then everything, all the land, water, our consciousness, everything can be purified by this Krishna consciousness. So thank you very much. Is there any comments or questions, realizations? Yes, Bhrigupati Prabhu. He's bringing a mic. I just talked about the stool. Yeah.
Yeah. As a matter of fact, it's really enclosed. I mean, we hear, you know, from the Bhagavatam, the first layer is earth, and then there's 10 times as that as the next layer of water, and you know, so I mean, they're really enclosed. So how is the sun reflecting light of the Brahma Jyoti? How does light from the Brahma Jyoti get into any universe?
I'm not sure exactly, but what comes to my mind, and maybe other people can participate, is that, you know, Lord Brahma was in the darkness of ignorance. There was no light. And if you're in darkness, how do you get light? That's basically your question, right? So he heard sound vibration, ta, pa. We mentioned a little bit about austerity. And by performing austerity, and he heard the transcendental sound, which is more important, that hearing this transcendental sound is so important, that he was enlightened. He received that. He actually heard the flute of Krishna, which is none different than Krishna. So Krishna appeared in his heart and enlightened his heart. And from that, Lord Brahma created the universe. He created the sun and all these different things. And technically, how it's reflecting the Brahma Jyoti is, you know, another thing that's beyond me. But maybe someone else, like Sach Dinoy, you have a, can...
Prabhu, I just have a, coming back to this important topic of the cows, wonderful, beautiful.
Yeah, I was just wondering, did you have a comment related to
this?
Oh,
no, not in this, I saw you finished.
First, let's see if there's anybody related to that. No? Okay, all right, go ahead, Prabhu.
So, having such a wonderful philosophy, wonderful, high philosophy, yeah, complete understanding, and the leading people are the devotees, we're supposed to be.
Right.
In your view, why is it that we're lacking this? How come we don't have much emphasis in this topic? Because just this topic can bring all the solutions, economical solutions, stress, many other things. Is it, what are we lacking on this? What, in your view, I just want you to see if you can, are we neglectful, lazy, or we're comfortable, we don't want to make enough austerity? How come we don't make it equal, even as we do, let's say, certain areas in preaching?
Yeah, like you said, I think it's all of the above that you mentioned. Lack of austerity, lack of understanding. So I think we just have to be, even within our movement, we have to understand properly this Krishna consciousness, the philosophy, what it really means to be a Brahman, to be a Vipra, you know, how the dangers of politics and so many different things that we bring in because of our own selfishness. What is our real motivation? Are we like Kamsa, so intensely selfish and motivated by our own desires that we will completely, our mind will get on this chariot and just take us so many places? Or are we just kind of focused on Krishna and perform austerity? Just like people might say, what happens to the marriage? You get married, you suppose you fell in love, what happened? Marriage was based on sense gratification. It will not last. It will create austerity, suffering, and pain. But if marriage based on sacrifice, real sacrifice, performing, following the principles, following the prescribed methods, it may be painful. Just like you have to deal, right? A woman and a man, you have to deal with the man, you have to deal with the woman. The man's psychology is completely different than the woman's. So you want that relationship, you got to put up with that sacrifice. You know, if you want to become spiritually minded, then you have to follow the principles. You have to perform austerity. And that is the pleasure. That's sacrifice. We may be unwilling to perform sacrifice because we don't understand. We think sacrifice, oh, I'm causing pain to myself. No, sacrifice, you're causing pleasure to yourself. This is pleasure. Krishna designed the material world in such a way that you can't get pleasure without sacrifice. But if you perform things without sacrifice, then it is austerity, it is suffering. Yeah, so, I don't know, my 2 cents worth. Yes, Bhrigupati Prabhu. Oh, good, what is the answer?
chapter 13 of the Bhagavad Gita, Krishna says, text 33, the sky, due to its subtle nature, does not mix with anything, although it is all-pervading. Mm. Similarly, the soul, situated in Brahman vision, does not mix with the body, though situated in the body. So it's a more subtle energy.
It just comes right through.
Yeah, it's pervading. It could
pervade
it's
anything, just, yeah. Krishna's everywhere. Mm. And that's real. When we fall in love with Krishna, man, mana, bhava, mad, bhakti, we see Krishna everywhere. We think of him. Mind, words, body, everything's absorbed in Krishna. Then you're with Krishna. Krishna's there. Yes, Prabhu.
Just on that topic also, isn't the sunlight emanating from the sun god, like from the Shamantaka jewel or from the body of the sun god?
Yeah, I mean, he's talking about where he gets it from, right? The sun god is he's like the deity.
Absorbed in Brahman.
Of the planet.
Brahman, I don't know, maybe he's kind of channeling that energy somehow.
Yeah. Exactly. Okay, any other comments, questions, realizations? Well, thank you for your kind attention. All glories to Srimad Bhagavatam, all glories to Srila Prabhupada. Jai.